This is the story of a man, a Turkish Muslim, a scholar, a preacher, and the global movement of social activists he inspires. In 2013, Time magazine named him one of the most influential leaders in the world. Because of his influence, at-risk children are now being educated in hundreds of countries. The sick are being treated, and the starving fed, often at great personal risk. It's also because of his influence and the collective power of the movement that Fethullah Gulen is feared and even reviled in his native Turkey. And as a Muslim leader of a powerful global movement, he is scrutinized in the United States, where he lives in self-imposed exile. To explore this controversial holy man and the movement of Turkish Muslims he inspires, we're going to examine Turkish history and Sufi mysticism and go to just a few of the places where these idealists are working to serve humanity in order to please God. The movement began in the 1960s on Turkey's west coast. Fethullah Gulen was a young preacher at the time, and his sermons were radically different from other religious men.
Normally, we go to mosques and we hear preaching about Islam, how Prophet behaved like this, this is what is written in Quran, etc., etc. I remember him speaking to university students. They were talking about thermodynamics and the first law, second law. After explaining this scientific issue, he added some verses from the Quran, and I was shocked with the combination of a scientific issue with a Quranic verse.
Gulen's message was that these are perfectly compatible with Muslim faith. A person can be a person of faith at the same time, a scientist can do science. Democracy is probably the best form of governance for everybody. So all his messages were positive. They were messages I was looking for.
Gulen not only showed the connection between Islam and science, he made the connection between Islam and modern democratic life, as well as service to God's creation.
He wants to convince people that to be Muslims, you can't just fulfill your ritual obligations. The service of God that you focus on in your ritual obligations has to shape your life and inform your life in terms of service to all humanity.
Turkey is a Muslim country. But because of its location at the crossroads of East and West, its historic appreciation of diversity, ethnic variety, mystical Sufi influences, and 20th century radical secularism, its interpretation of Islam is unique in the Muslim world.
Since they were on the very edge of the West, they were on the edge of Europe, they discovered modernity before other Muslim societies. So when you went back to a century ago in Istanbul, you would have Muslim liberals speaking how compatible Islam and liberalism is, or how compatible Islam and democracy is, and they would have Islamic arguments for those things.
The Ottoman Empire was known for its interfaith, intercultural openness. It was very hospitable to Catholics. The Ottoman Empire provided hospitality and welcome to the Jews when they were fleeing the Inquisition.
Turkish Islam has been always more tolerant, basically because Turkey was an empire which lasted more than 600 years, could not be a theocracy. There was a built-in tolerance, not because they had good hearts and they were enlightened and so on, but the logic of the institution, imperial institution, forced them to be tolerant towards others.
But after the Ottoman Empire's defeat in World War I, and its subsequent collapse. Ideas about progressive or democratic Islam were abandoned in favor of a fiercely enforced secularism. Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, war hero and first president of Turkey, is the only man in the world who can be credited with almost single-handedly creating a republic out of an empire. And he did it by creating an ideology that was antithetical to the Ottoman Islamic mindset. Looking to the West as a model, Atatürk believed that modernizing Turkey could only be accomplished by abandoning traditional Islamic culture. To enforce Turkey's emancipation from religion, he implemented strict laws and policies that effectively removed it from public life and politics.
A secular state means separation, which means freedom to believe or not to believe. And in fact, secularism in Turkey in the old days was a very negative about religion and in fact anti-Islam.
They believe that if a person is faithful, they cannot think rationally. Therefore, they are not fit to govern themselves. Therefore, until people are ready, they believed, they should be governed with an authoritarian system.
To protect the people from their own weakness for faith and maintain the power once afforded to religious authority during the Ottoman times, Turkey's secular government exercised complete control over religion. In 1966, Fethullah Gulen was a young preacher appointed to a state-monitored Quranic school, where his popularity grew in direct proportion to his pious pragmatism.
He began saying, what Turkey needs right now, like all of the Middle East, is education for its young people. We need to teach people, not in madrasas, not in mosques, but we need to teach them math and science and notions of democracy.
Ama Allah'ın rızası, herkes belli bir yolla onu takip eder. Kimisi cephede, serhatlarda askerlik yapar, onu takip eder. Kimisi tekkede, zaviyede, post nişindir, orada takip eder. Benim inancıma göre en önemli mesele eğitimdir. İnsana yapılan yatırımdır. Şirkin
onun hakkında... By the late 1970s, Fethullah Gulen had attracted a solid core of Turkish businessmen who were opening tutoring centers and dormitories to help students outside of the elite class. Eventually, they began to build schools. In 1982, the first school established by the followers of Fethullah Gulen opened in Western Turkey. It had only 18 students at the time, a number that has swelled to over 600, with most boarding at the school.
I think living here is better than home because here we can study with our teachers. And the best students in Turkey are coming here.
And are you the best student?
Yes. My favorite subject is biology. I like the bugs and insects, the little animals.
I want to become doctor and I want to go to the different country, foreign country.
I want to be famous like Dr. Oz.
Do you have a boyfriend?
No, never.
Do you have a girlfriend?
I, that's all it.
Gulen is not a liberal emancipator of any kind. He's a very religious person. But if I were to judge by what Gulen was preaching, he is preaching equality of sexes. He is calling on girls to educate themselves.
Today, Turkey's Gulen-inspired schools are known for academic achievement, conservative moral values, and round-the-clock attention to the students. A model that opened the door to higher education for children who don't belong to the secular elite ruling class. But Fethullah Gulen's democratic vision was a global one.
Dünyanın dört bir yanına göç tertip edecek arkadaşlarımız. Müminin niyeti amelinden hayırlıdır esasına dayanarak halis niyetle dört bir yana şeddi rihal etsin gitsinler.
Saraybosna şehri kuşatma altında kalmış. Tabi Saraybosna'ya giriş farklı tünelden. Karanlıkta, ayaklarınızın altları su, havasız, arkanızda, sırtınızda çantanız. Fiziksel şartları zordu ama biz hedefimize vardığımız için çok sevinçliydik açıkçası. Çok mutluyduk, mutlu olmuştuk.
As the movement was gaining momentum in Turkey, the war in Bosnia was pitting Muslims, Eastern Orthodox Serbians and Croatian Catholics against each other. Sarajevo sustained the longest siege of a capital in the history of modern warfare. Nearly 12,000 civilians were killed and 56,000 more wounded. But these two men, armed only with their desire to please God through service and with only $300 between them, crawled through a tunnel to get into the war zone, not as soldiers, but as teachers.
Bizi Hocaefendi buraya yardım etmek için, buradaki insanların yardımına koşmak için gönderdi.
Biz burada nasıl olacak, kim, hayatta mı kalacağız, aç mı kalacağız, susuz mu kalacağız? Daha çok buraya varmak bizim için bir hedefti.
Bombalar düşüyor, savaş devam ediyor. Hocam belki biz orada ölebiliriz, dönemeyebiliriz. O zaman ne yapalım? İşte bizim hiç olmazsa cenaze namazımızı uzakta da olsanız kılabilir misiniz? Hocaefendi orada duygulandı biraz, gözleri buğulandı, bakışları sertleşti ve ben sizi gönderiyorum oraya ölmeye değil, ben sizi oraya hizmet etmeye, okul açmaya gönderiyorum. Allah yardımcınız olsun, Allah yolunuzu açsın. İşte her gün gidiyorduk bakanın oraya, özellikle İbrahim abiler. Her gün bakanın oraya gidiyoruz, geliyoruz, gidiyoruz. Bir gün işte ne okulu, devlet düşmek üzere, halk perişan, okul olmaz. Ama biz ya hiç bırakmadık kapıyı çalmayı, sürekli kapıyı çaldık, çaldık, çaldık. Bir gün bizi çağırdılar, tamam size okul binasını vereceğiz. Bir Sırp kışlasını bize ilk defa okul binası verdiler.
To pay for the school that people in the movement had already risked their lives for, Fethullah Gulen's followers in Istanbul organized a charity soccer match featuring world-famous player Diego Maradona. It was their first large-scale effort as a movement, and Gulen himself spoke to the enormous crowd.
Sporun diliyle, evrensel sporun diliyle, dünya medyasına, dünya halklarına, hususiyle Sami infiali içinde öteden beri olan bunca fezai ve fecai arenada kavga edenleri seyrediyor gibi seyreden alemi İslam halklarına bir şey anlatır mülazasıyla. Bir kere de evrensel sporun diline sığındık.
The event raised enough money to open three schools in Bosnia, one of which was attended by Syed Amic, who remembers his Turkish teacher and lessons of love and forgiveness.
When I see Mr. Ali, with his smile, he is taking your heart. There is no badness in him. What do we need in the world? Food, drinking, just to save our life. But they come and they are going to teach us. For us, it was very unbelievable. In our school, there are Serbian, Croatian, Bosnian, and they really teach us, you cannot hit me, how much can I love you? Let's try to love people. And that teacher come here and teach us something like that. If they didn't come here, I never be thinking like now. Maybe I will hate that people from another side.
Decades after the war, the Turks remain in their adopted country as teachers as well as sponsors.
We live together and we sing together, Muslims, Catholics, Orthodox. We must respect each other. We must respect culture each other. We must respect religion each other. Because we have only one God, and He's created us.
There is a level of cynicism that I think those of us in the West, many of us, have to confront when we encounter a movement of people like the Gulen movement, because they are very committed to what they do and they live deeply from their values. I have asked them, hundreds of them, what draws you to this movement? How did you get involved in this movement? And for many of them, they wanted their children to go to the best schools, and the best schools that were academically going to be the ones that prepared their children were the schools started by Gulen people. But what kept them in the movement was this vision of living their own lives in such a way that there's meaning and value and happiness from that, but also making a difference in the world, making the world a safe place for everyone, including their own children. And I felt really confronted on a personal level, not just as a professional, but personally I felt confronted by it because I realized that I myself had become cynical and didn't really believe that people could operate and live in the world from those types of clean motives.
The movement is known as the Hizmet movement, after the Turkish word for service, and also the Gulen movement, after its inspiration, Fethullah Gulen.
He is a person who helps me put my life on a solid foundation in terms of making meaning in my life, in terms of having the serenity of my heart as to why I live, what my life serves.
There are so many things that you have to do, but you start losing yourself. So getting together in the sohbet, you restructure all your priorities, and that's with that, you start feeling human again.
Gulen's followers meet weekly in small groups called sohbets, where they recommit to their values, share ideas, and work on charitable projects.
It can be a scholarship, or it can relate to the Ramadan. We try to help the community, we try to help the students, we try to help the poor.
This is not about individual enlightenment. This is about making the world a better place. But while I'm making the world a better place, at the same time, this altruism is also transformative.
Actually, his most important message is, of course, that work hard, make money, use that money to invest in things that will help the people improve their lives, and that's education, that's hospitals, health services, that's also solidarity associations and foundations that will cater to the needs of the poor.
The exchange of ideas and beliefs with people of other faiths and cultures is a cornerstone of Gulen's teaching. To increase dialogue and friendship between Muslims, Jews, and Christians, Gulen reached out to Sephardi Chief Rabbi Bakshi Doron of Israel, as well as Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew I of Constantinople.
Sayın hocanızla birbirimizi çok seviyoruz. Eminim ki burada hazır bulunanlardan kimse buna kıskanmıyor.
In recognition of his efforts in interfaith work, the Vatican invited Fethullah Gulen to meet Pope John Paul II.
Biz böyle yan yana durduğumuz zaman bazı kimseleri tanıma imkanını bulacağız. Biz hepimiz de belki bir dönemde böyle tek taraflı, sadece kendi düşüncemizi iltizam, kendi cephemizi iltizam ve karşı tarafı ademe mahkum etme, ne olursa olsun onları silme süpürme atma gibi mülahazalarla. Öyle bir kültür ortamında yetiştik. Belki o günlere mahsus olmak üzere hissiyatımızı ifade ederken feveranlarımız da oldu. Üslup hatalarımız oldu. Ama dünyanın akıbeti böyle çok kötüye doğru kaydığı bir dönemde şimdi bunları daha iyi fark ediyoruz. Bunlara meydan vermemek lazım.
After 9/11, interfaith dialogue and tolerance became very fashionable in the world for understandable reasons. But the Gulen movement began interfaith dialogue and tolerance in the 90s, way before 9/11, way before it was really fashionable, because it's in the core of their teaching.
In addition to raising money for interfaith activities in schools, the movement now owns a think tank, a book publisher, a television station, and Zaman, the newspaper with the highest circulation in Turkey. Partly because of the movement's success, Fethullah Gulen is as reviled by some as he is revered by others. In Turkey, his critics have expressed concern that he will bring Sharia law. He has also been accused of conspiring with everyone from the CIA to Zionists and Catholics.
There are so many people following the, you know, footsteps in moral sense of Fethullah Gulen, but they also have a political power, and they also have the power to have to build up networks. Now, what about if these people go into the bureaucracy and, you know, have a kind of a their own hierarchy within the bureaucracy? So, some people would say, this is a state within a state, maybe. You know?
Some people of Turkish society, they afraid from that. They said, we don't know what will they do. Yes, they are praying, they are doing something on the educational side, on the trade side, commercial side, but we don't know what will they do.
In 1999, Fethullah Gulen came to the U.S. for medical treatment. In his absence from Turkey, he was accused by a special government prosecutor of leading an Islamist network intent on undermining the secular Turkish government.
The establishment felt threatened by this rise of sort of a middle-class bourgeois movement, and that it had this religious leader, you know, used Sufi ideas about tolerance and about education, about sharing, and about everybody having part of the economic pie. And so I think that was the greatest challenge to the establishment. And so what they did is they used their anti-terror law and charged him as a terrorist, basically.
When you have the kind of ideology that the military particularly had, and some of the really hardline secular elites, they did not trust anyone. And therefore, anyone who was associated with a public organization that was, yes, Muslim and Islamically oriented, but not an Islamic political movement, that really didn't matter. And so I think there were concerns about ultimately his security.
In poor health, Fethullah Gulen remained in self-imposed exile at a retreat in Pennsylvania while awaiting the outcome of his trial. The movement was already in the United States, establishing interfaith dialogue and cultural institutions. Eventually, a group of Turkish educators influenced by Gulen's ideas began opening charter schools.
All of our schools are located in urban environments. So we serve predominantly minority students and predominantly students who are coming from economically disadvantaged families. So when you work with this student population, motivation is very important.
I'm the college counselor. And also I'm teaching the advanced math classes. 6 times 6. We know if you have a better score on ACT, you can get the scholarship. I am willing to help them during the summertime. At least 2 or 3 days I will be in my office. I will provide the practice tests.
I had the lowest self-esteem before coming over to Horizon. It's so hard for me to learn something and to memorize it. Other schools would be like, oh, well, if you fail this class, you fail it. These teachers actually search for us and say, I want you to pass this class. And they spend as much time as you need them to explaining what you don't get. And they don't complain.
And there's definitely days when I go home and I'm exhausted. I'm like, oh my gosh, why am I doing this? But then there's also times when you see the relationships you've built with kids and you see the relationships that you've built with your school and your community, where it's all worth it.
People don't go into these schools to make money, right? They go in because they're dedicated. The reason I have great respect for the schools is because they really go into poor areas and work with kids that if they were in the public school system, wouldn't be getting anywhere.
Charter schools, like all public schools, are prohibited from teaching religion. However, these charter schools attract scrutiny because of their perceived association with an influential Muslim leader.
The only connection to Fethullah Gulen is some of the Turkish-American educators who founded these schools or involved in these schools at a personal level. They were inspired by Fethullah Gulen and his ideas about, you know, serving communities, serving people, regardless of their backgrounds.
Can we agree or disagree with three?
Although most of the teachers in the U.S. charter schools are American, critics point out that taxpayers are paying for the visas of international teachers and have expressed fears of insidious exposure to Islam.
I think that people in the movement are concerned because they realize that even though the movement is not somehow a, quote, Islamic political movement, that's the way in which people in Turkey have tried to cast them, that is the hardline secularist, and it gets picked up in this country among those who are just simply, we have a strong minority of people who are anti-Islam and anti-Muslim. And so for them, if you say this is a Muslim movement, immediately there will be all of these suspicions about, well, what are they doing?
They've also come at a time when the United States and the Western culture is in a convulsion about Islam. And there are people, huge chunks of people, who've already made up their mind that Islam is a deadly religion and that people in it are deadly, are up to trickery, and cannot be trusted. And there are certain members in that viewpoint who will never be converted to another viewpoint, no matter what anybody does.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Hayya ala salah, Hayya ala salah.
As part of their commitment to interfaith dialogue, the movement hosts small groups comprised of people from various traditions in Turkey several times a year. The idea is Turkish hospitality on a personal level, as well as an introduction to Turkish history and holy sites.
I've discovered some things about my own Catholic faith, my own Christian commitment, by seeing something very different in a Muslim's relationship with God. The difference itself invites me into deeper reflection. Why is that different? You know? And do I envy something about that difference?
I can pick up a book and read about anybody's faith or anybody's culture, right? But it will never give me the understanding, an interaction with a person from that faith. So absolutely, I think interfaith is vital.
In Konya, Scott Alexander and Safa Zarzur visit the tomb shrine of Jalal ad-Din Rumi. The 13th century poet, theologian, and Sufi mystic, important to the movement for his emphasis on tolerance, reason, charity, and love.
This is a poem written in the 13th century, and the opening of this epic poem is the story of the reed. You know, it's got that evocative, breathy sound, right? Mm-hmm. But it's a melancholy sound. And what Rumi hears in it is the sound of a longing to return. The reed gets cut from the reed bed, mm-hmm. okay? And in order to make the flute. Mm-hmm. And the song of the reed is the longing of the reed to return to the reed bed.
Oh, wow.
And that's the symbol of the human soul that longs to return to God.
No.
The dervishes walk out cloaked in very dark woolen garments. The cylindrical headgear is to represent the tombstone. The dark woolen garments is to represent the earth of the grave. And as they walk in a circle, they doff their dark woolen cloaks and are in their white burial shrouds. And then they will begin to whirl. Their arms are over their chests. And then they will begin to open their arms, extending their right palm toward heaven and their left palm toward the earth, whirling on the left leg, which crosses through the axis of the heart, symbolizing that the heart is somehow the link between the heaven and the earth. And it's the heart where one encounters God most profoundly in one's life. And they begin to lose consciousness of the workaday world and enter into the state of losing oneself in the awesome presence of God.
Another strand in Sufism is intellectual or philosophical Sufism, a sort of understanding of the real behind the real. You know, the Quran says the signs of God are upon the horizons and in yourself. So Rumi's philosophy expands on that so that everything becomes, you know, seeing God in all things type of Sufism. And then the third strand is activism, change the world, be like the prophet who realized the highest truths, but then brought that back in the world to make the world a better place. You can really connect the dots historically right to Mr. Fethullah Gulen.
I was always asking my teacher, Miss Aisha, teacher, why you came here? Why you came to this country? And she was saying, to help you, to educate you.
Nergis Halid is a member of the sizable Kurdish population in northern Iraq. She was a student at one of the Gulen schools when the building was bombed during the war.
The plane came and the windows of the school break down, and it was, we said that this is the last, this is the end of the world. But the teachers here, none of them, even they didn't go to Turkey. They were here. They were calling their families, we are with them, don't be sad, we are fine, nothing is happening. It was, I cannot express it, how was it. As I said, I cannot not stop myself when I'm thinking about it. Always, I start to cry.
Good morning, ladies.
Good morning, teacher.
Like many students of Gulen-inspired teachers, Nergis has returned to her former school as a teacher.
Come to the next page. Come to the next page. Rahel, can you read it for me?
Give up. So, okay.
Lots of times I'm thinking about the people around me, especially my students. They are really taking me as an example, as a model.
Mother, why
when you do something, if it's correct or if it's wrong, they are imitating. Any action, any word that you are saying, anything that you are doing, you have to be careful about it. You have to be a human that God wants. Oh my God!
Sister Martha Ann Kirk, a Catholic nun from San Antonio, Texas, has made several trips to Iraq to document the work of the movement.
We stayed in the dorm together. In the mornings, when she wakes up, she looks at the sky. Oh, thanks God for a new day. This is something that I learned from her, to be thankful for a new day.
Now I want you to tell me about what you want to be when you're an adult.
I want to be an engineer.
Engineer. Okay, engineer. Engineer or designer?
Doctor.
A doctor. How about you?
Teacher.
A teacher? Are you going to teach English like she does?
Yeah.
Good.
Salam alaikum.
Salam.
Yesterday, my mom, she was telling my father, you love Nergis more than the others. You love Nergis most. And my father always, because she is different. When I hear this answer inside myself, I answer him, Father, it's not from me. It's from the school. I learned all these things from the school.
Teachers.
The former Secretary General of the United Nations, Kofi Annan, said, nothing is more important for the development of a country than the education of girls.
When I was 15 years old, I decided to be an engineer. I like that because I said that for my city, engineer will be very nice because there are a lot of projects.
Connie Hassan is one of the first graduates of the movement's high school for girls in Sulaymaniyah, Iraq.
The most important project for me was the water project. Nearly a half of Sulaymaniyah needed that water project. Now they get water from that. We poured concrete from 6 o'clock because about 10 at night we were in here.
Pouring concrete.
With the man. And, yeah.
How much does something like this cost?
This project costs $30 million. You know that here, they say that engineering is not for girls.
What does your mother think of your choices?
My mother, she don't agree with me, but I'm very happy now. I like to do that. At first, the man didn't believe us, yeah. But now, when I showed my ability and I worked, I insisted in that. I said I can do it. And when I show my ability, now they can take me to that project and I now continue with that.
Healthcare is another one of the movement's priorities. So businessmen in the movement invest in private hospitals like this one in Erbil, Iraq.
Every week, we get one or two patients with bomb injuries, shell injuries, bullet injuries. Those patients come from all around Iraq.
The patient sustained injury to his both legs due to a bomb attached to his car.
We constructed the nerve and artery. Now we are dealing with the fractures.
The other room is our microsurgery room.
Dr. Bayrak Tar, a microsurgeon, was working in Istanbul when he heard about the new hospital in Erbil.
I started coming here since 2009. 1 month here, 1 month in Istanbul, my home is there. And then last year, an accident happened to a young guy here. He amputated his arm. My friends called me, come back and do the operation. It was very hard to come here. Within 4-6 hours, I couldn't be here. That's why the man lost his arm. So I made the decision to stay here and brought my family too.
Although many patients are paying customers, Fethullah Gulen's teaching is evident in that everyone who needs treatment receives it regardless of their ability to pay.
When you are needed, you live better, you know. You have better self-esteem. If you are in Istanbul and you know that you can do this thing in Erbil and you are not doing it and people are suffering because you are not coming to do that and nobody is coming to do that, you couldn't sleep at night. Right.
Orada günde binlerce çocuğun ölümü beni çok etkiledi ve ben kesinlikle gitmem gerektiğini düşündüm.
Sonra yine açarım.
Çocuklarımın aklının sağlıklı olmasının, bedenen gelişimlerinin iyi olmasının hepsinin sadakasını vermek için gittim.
After seeing news reports about the tens of thousands of Somalis dying of starvation and diseases caused by malnutrition, Doctors Amina Al-Yaprak and Jalal Kadu decided to go where they were most needed, to one of the most dangerous spots on Earth.
There is no water, there is no food, there is no medicine, there is nothing, nothing, only kimse yokmu in Somalia.
Disaster relief is a major initiative of the movement. Their organization, Kimse Yokmu, Turkish meaning, is anybody out there, goes all over the world to aid people suffering from catastrophe, often at great personal risk to the volunteer workers.
Sumini'ye geldiğimizde yağmurla karşılaştık. Yağmur güzeldi ama bizim için olumsuzdu çünkü karton kutular içerisinde yaklaşık 21 kutu ilaç vardı. Onların ıslanması falan endişelendirdi bizi.
I bring a good ultrasound machine which is helping to me for diagnosis, for examination the patients.
In Mogadishu, the heavily guarded headquarters of Kimse Yokmu also serves as the living quarters for the volunteer workers. Over 4,000 refugees are living in this densely populated camp alone, hoping for enough food and water to survive the famine and drought that's expected to take the lives of one-third of the Somali population.
Çadırda yaşıyorlar diyoruz Türkiye'deki insanlar ama çadır burada gördüğünde inanamıyorsun yani. Çadır dediğimiz sadece ağaçlarla örülmüş bir iskelet, üzerine sadece kumaş örtülmüş. Yağmur yağdığında bu insanlar ne yapabilirler hiç düşünemiyorum bile.
Çok kötü şartlar ya.
Hanım kendim huyu sizde lo kaptı.
Sabık malaria ile
yani
almışım.
Şey dedi malariyesi var.
Bir de mantıga
var mantıga. Mantıga var şu. Hastaneye gitmiş mi?
Hastanemizde tadı kor.
Hanan Abdullah burada gel. Tamam.
Hanan diye bir yere götürdük. Reçeteler bizim yanında.
Ona söyle gelsin bizim oraya.
Evet, tamam.
İlaçlarını vereceğiz ona.
Tamam. Üç tane veriyorum.
Ona kesin var. Getirmemin öncelikli olarak muayene ederiz onu.
Hayır.
The doctors set up a makeshift clinic in an old building. An endless stream of others wait patiently outside for their turn.
Today I went to biggest hospital in the Mogadishu, one of the biggest one. One patient was bleeding and she need emergency operation. There was a big surprise for me because there is no instrument and there was three assistant who is trained in Turkey just 3 months. Thanks to Allah, everything was okay and finished.
Once a month, the Kimse Yokmu volunteer doctors go to the prison to check the health of the 1,400 incarcerated men and women. The organization also provides a complete meal for all the prisoners once a day.
بي هذا العلم عن ملها ما هيسنن بويد بيو كانت ما هيسنن بي معان ما هيستان محابس لو حي كوجيران ميل كل بي كوجيران ماشا كل لي كوجيران مركي بي ماشونا اي كل شيء بي بنان نو كو قبيستو عن عن بوكينيا عن عن بوكينيا جيرود جوقتي نقونيسا
متلف صابون alacak da almadı bak kıvır değil.
Gardiyanlar onlara sabun verir mi? Zor yani, el koyarlar.
Mütelifse bunu unuttun yine mütelif. Oo. Mütelif var ya mütelif.
Abdülmütelif var ya.
Öyle ilaç yok diyeceğim mütelif ilaç. Kısa bir süre önce oraya yatakları kimse yok mu getirmiş yoksa direkt yerde yatıyorlarmış. Onlara gelirken elbise getirdik. Kokulu temiz mendiller, temizlik için kullanılacak mendiller getirdik. Hizmet birçok ülkeye gitmiş. Neyle? Öğretmenlerle, okulla gitmiş. İlk olarak biz girdik Somali'ye. Yani yardım için, hizmet olarak ilk biz geldik doktorlar. Bununla gurur duyuyorum.
There are hundreds and hundreds of social movements rooted in religious traditions. All of these movements are service movements. What is unique about the Gulen movement is number one, it's Turkish, and number two, it's Islamic. I mean, that's about it. And my take on that is, isn't that wonderful? That there's so many movements with the same goals, the same directions. I think we ought to celebrate that. There's enough work in the world, as much needy people, as we can proliferate movements.
After 8 long years, Fethullah Gulen was finally acquitted in the Turkish Supreme Court of Appeals. During that time, Turkey was trying to enter the European Union, which required the establishment of civil liberties and abolishing the security courts where Mr. Gulen was initially indicted. Still, he has yet to return to Turkey.
He's a very cautious man. He knows that the day he will come here, he will be greeted by millions of people. It will upset the government. It will upset the military. It will upset the secular forces.
At an educational Olympics sponsored by the movement, Turkish Prime Minister Erdogan invited Fethullah Gulen to return home. But despite a longing that's evident, Gulen regretfully declined the invitation.
Türkiye'de yeni yeni problemlerin olmaması, bir kısım huzursuzlukların çıkmaması, bir kısım kazanımların hafizanallah kaybedilmemesi için %1 ihtimalle oraya gitmeniz bu hususlara zarar verecekse, işte ben o endişeyle şahsım adına değil de o endişeyle gitmek istemem.
I think it's really, really difficult to be Fethullah Gulen. Now he's an international person. He's not considered only a Turkish saying this or that, but he's considered as a Muslim leader. Whatever you say is repeated with the followers in those countries. So his message shouldn't be misunderstood by anybody on the globe, and it is very difficult.
You have somebody who's come here and basically has been invisible. He does not choose to be on TV. He does not choose to move around the country to give public meetings. He does not even choose to meet with significant numbers of his followers. He lives a rather monkish kind of life.
İnsanların böyle insan öldürmeye, cinayetlere, zulümlere, haksızlıklara, şiddetlere, hiddetlere kilitlendiği bir dönemde bu şiddet, bu hiddet ne ölçüde kırılabilirse ben onu şahsen insanlık adına çok önemli bir şey sayıyorum. Evet, insanların insanca yaşamalarını, insan ufka yükselmelerini, birbirleriyle sarmaş dolaş olmalarını, Hazreti Mevlana'nın oluşturmaya çalıştığı o ufkun oluşmasını, o atmosferin oluşmasını, kinlerin, nefretlerin gömülmesi, üzerine kayaların yerleştirilmesi, bir daha hortlamasına meydan verilmemesi, bunu istiyorum ben. Siz de onu isteyin.
Allah.
I think he is spiritually bonded to God himself. You think you are praying to the same God at the same time. What I need to say while with him is, oh my God, please give what Fethullah Gulen is asking for you. Instead of saying something from me, I feel like I should just say Ameen to what he is asking for.